delighted to have a very special presenter with us, Dr. Barbara Fears from Howard University School of Divinity. Dr. Fears has been a very strong advocate for race equity and justice and throughout her work. She is the Assistant Professor of Religious Education at the Howard University School of Divinity, and she teaches courses in history and philosophy and practice of ministry. She brings a unique background in chaplaincy and other areas of ministerial engagement. She identifies as a womanist practical theologian, a critical race theorist, and a critical pedagogue. Her research focuses on matters of power and privilege, accountability and faith formation, the praxis of faith, and in curriculum development. Recent works include a book review and critical race theory in education, an entry for Dr. Mary Boies in the Database of Christian Educators of the 20th Century, which is a remarkable database, recommended to everyone, and article Race, Disability, and COVID-19, a discrete analysis of theological education. Dr. Fears has participated in Howard University, a junior faculty summer writing and creative works academy, and the workshop for early career theological school faculty sponsored by the Wabash Center for Teaching. And we are delighted to welcome her. Our process today is this. We ask that everyone remain muted except for our speaker. And we will hear from Dr. Fears. And when it's time for discussion, we ask you to unmute only as you are sharing a question or sharing a response. And we will share those ground rules when we reach that phase. So I am delighted to turn this over now to Dr. Fears.
Thank you. Good afternoon. Many thanks to Dr. Larry Gelman for this invitation to discuss a subject matter that's near and dear to my heart. To my Howard University colleagues for their presence and their prayers. To my co-laborers in the Vineyard of Theological Education in the Washington Consortium and elsewhere. For your attention and interest in this very important topic, critical race theory and theological education. And to students and guests for your time and participation in this conversation that affects the lives of persons to whom we profess a divine call to serve. I anticipate and look forward to a robust discussion and debate. So let us begin. I, along with many people here and around the world, watched in shock as persons reportedly disappointed over the 2020 presidential election, presumed believers in the big lie, left the Stop and Steal rally and subsequently stormed the U.S. Capitol on January 6, 2021. In conversations with friends, family, and colleagues of a certain age, ancestry, geography, with particular knowledge of U.S. history and race relations, and even victims of the pandemic Zoom bombings where threats were made on our lives, the pictures streaming through our various electronic devices stirred emotional recollections of childhood experiences and childhood stories from the Jane Crow era that ended on paper in 1964 with the signing of the Civil Rights Act by then President Lyndon Johnson. The memories, emotions, and thoughts that flooded our bodies as we watched those images generated near trauma level responses. Feelings range from horror to concern to shock to sadness to fear to outrage to calm. Here I refer to calm as blessed assurance, reminding us we have seen this movie before, we have receipts, and we have overcome. Blacks have routine experiences with microaggressions. That is, experiences, warning signs that remind us on a regular that we are Black and must be mindful of space and place. Some among us have been a part of the historical Black moments and or certainly have seen the documentation that cannot be erased of the outrage surrounding Ruby Bridges, the Little Rock Nine, and the Freedom Riders attempting to take by force a right, a privilege, a position presumed to be a divinely ordained and government mandated for them alone. And yet, in the words of Maya Angelou, still like dust, we rise. I highlight this occasion because the behavior and the image of the insurrectionists on that January day and their supporters exemplify the hegemonic backlash manifested in response to every real or imagined civil rights advancement for people of color. The Klan, Knight Riders, political rhetoric, legislative changes, all serve to discourage, dehumanize, and disenfranchise people of color. I highlight this occasion more importantly because the coordinated act of aggression provides a visual, for some, a visceral reaction, and it best epitomizes the toxic racial power structure operational in this country that critical race theorists highlight, seek to deconstruct, and to overturn, or at the very least, to undermine. The conspiracy between the members of the working class and the well-connected to maintain power, whether with images of the cross, a symbol of Christian faith, and with flags, symbols of national and geographical allegiance, well illustrate the risk to and the reasons for those of us in theological education to understand and to employ the fundamental tenets of critical race theory in our teaching, our research, and our service as a matter of ethical religious praxis, sound doctrinal inquiry, and responsible public witness in a nation plagued by what Black feminist and cultural critic Bell Hooks has called imperialist white capitalist patriarchy. In Seeing Race Again, edited by Kimberly Crenshaw and others, the authors assert that contemporary social conditions shaped by the histories of white supremacy are linked to the construction and disavowal of race within the academic disciplines themselves. Employing critical race theory in theological education will enable us to reveal race and racism across our respective disciplines, most specifically as a theological, anthropological issue that manifests in tangible ways, even in sacred spaces. Moreover, according to noted critical race theorist Gloria Latsom Billings, and I quote, adopting and adapting CRT as a framework for educational equity means that we will have to expose racism in education and propose radical solutions for addressing it, end quote. While there is no canonical beliefs to which all critical race theorists subscribe, I will explicate briefly select assertions fundamental to the theory, then offer ways that we can engage just one of its many themes, the critique of liberalism, which is the rejection of objectivity, neutrality, meritocracy, and colorblindness. I conclude with some general remarks about education in the settler colony, since so many students have come to us having already been shaped and formed in a dysfunctional K-12 system that is not designed to support creative and critical thought. As you know, critical race theory is currently under attack by both the ill-informed who misunderstand the work of CR theorists engaged in racial equity advocacy, and by the well-informed who misrepresent the analytical tool as a wedge issue for election purposes. In fact, according to Derek Bell, legal scholar, CRT father and founder, and I quote, "Conservative politicians gain and hold even the highest office despite their failure to address serious issues. They rely instead on the time-tested formula of getting needy whites to identify on the basis of their shared skin color and suggest that white people must stand against the Willie Hortons or against racial quotas or against affirmative action. The code words differ, the message is the same. Whites rally on the basis of racial pride and patriotism. Crucial to this situation is the unstated understanding by the mass of whites that they will accept large disparities in economic opportunity in respect to other whites as long as they have priority over blacks and other people of color." In reality, critical race theory is a 50-year-old movement initiated in the 1970s by legal scholars, lawyers, and activists, discouraged by the slow implementation, even rollback of civil rights legislation from the 1950s and 60s. CRT scholars examine the relationship between race and power, note the statistically significant disparities regarding access and opportunities across an array of disciplines, healthcare, criminal justice, education, for example, between white lives and that of people of color, and offer correctives to bridge the gaps. Foundational for critical race theorists is that racism is institutional, woven into the very fabric and interrelated structures of this nation. Racism is endemic to US society, the normal way of doing business, the common everyday experiences of people of color. In fact, according to CR legal scholars, Richard Delgado and Jean Stefanchik, by every social indicator, racism continues to blight the lives of people of color, including holders of high echelon jobs. Police community encounters are daily reminders that this continues to happen. Let me be clear. Racism is prejudice plus power, which people of color do not possess, in that we are not seated in large numbers as decision makers in Congress, business, education, politics, judiciary, or military to enforce any racial prejudice we may hold. In fact, we are more likely to internalize racial self-hatred. Thus, whites alone possess this positional power despite the shifting demographics in this country. Another tenet of critical race theory is that whites benefit from racism and thus have no incentive to eradicate it. Poor and working class persons of European descent have benefited psychologically from racism since acquiring the white racial designation previously reserved for land-owning Brits. White was an attribute of freedom and thus of personhood, a shield against enslavement and exclusion of civil liberties. Elite whites, on the other hand, benefit materially, politically, financially, and by having a buffer group that continues to protect their interests. The psychological and material investment in racism explains, at least in part, another tenet of critical race theory, what is known as interest convergence, which asserts that whites will tolerate civil rights advances for people of color as long as whites benefit. Here, Bell argued that the true beneficiaries of the Brown versus Board of Education ruling that ordered the desegregation of schools with all deliberate speed were white people, or more specifically, the US image abroad, as the national leaders sought to curb communism around the world, and thus needed images of protest off the screen. Critical race theorists reject liberalism, specifically the legal claims of neutrality, objectivity, meritocracy, leprosy and color blindness. In a country founded on promoting the self-interest of European colonial expansion, laws have never been neutrally or objectively established or applied, as is evident in the founding documents hailing life, liberty, and pursuit of happiness while simultaneously denying the same to the enslaved. Moreover, the same system that legally delineates access to resources and opportunities based on race has routinely found one group more meritorious than others. Therefore, it seems oxymoronic to suggest skin color has no significance in a country where skin color has been legally meaningful from the start. Moreover, since this term is applied only to race, aside from a legitimate medical condition, it allows one to pretend to ignore what one has already noticed, thereby denying to attribute either positive or pejorative stereotypes to skin color. For law professor Neil Gotanda, the claim that race is not recognized is an attempt to deny the reality of internally recognized social conflicts of race and ultimately supports the supremacy of white interest. Finally, race is not biological, but is social, legal, and theological constructs that yield material consequences. Modern science has proven there is only one race, human, that originated in Africa. Nevertheless, the Enlightenment era concept of biological differences still prevail. For example, a recent University of Virginia study found that scientifically trained residents and medical students believe that Blacks are biologically different than whites and thus can withstand more pain. This racial bias translates into doctors not only ill-treating and under-prescribing pain medications for Black patients relative to white patients, but doing so relative to World Health Organization. As a legal construct, the law defines race as a social category and defines also the access and restrictions of persons based upon those definitions. Blacks in this strange land were legally designated property, enslaved for life, forbidden to marry interracially, denied education, citizenship, and voting rights. Whites, by contrast, were defined on the basis of negation. In other words, whites are those who are not non-white and thus became characteristically polar opposites of that which was considered to defile non-whites. Admittedly, there is some debate about which came first, whether religion influenced society or society influenced religion. Nevertheless, the two are intertwined, and thus theology has contributed to definitions of race and racial differences. According to Afro-French psychiatrist Franz Fanon, all human exploitation finds legitimation in scripture. The religious founders of this settler nation labeled Native Americans savages and Africans heathens, thereby justifying the theft of indigenous land and the theft and enslavement of African people. For what womanist theologian Kelly Brown Douglas has suggested was the building of an Anglo-Saxon nation virtually synonymous with building a religious nation. Likewise, for law professor Kiara Bridges, modern biological racism is rooted in pre-modern religious antipathy and has been applied to what we typically think of as religious designation, that is to Jews and Muslims, who have been racialized and also denied basic rights. For James Carroll, however, ideas of racial purity as a component of social identity influence religious identity, leading to a notion of Christianity stripped of all Semitic influence. By equating Christianity with European American culture, and by claiming Christianity superior to Judaism and all other religions, Christianity made European American culture superior to all ethnic cultural identities. Similarly, for James Perkinson, Christian supremacy is what gave birth to white supremacy. Despite the debate, there is no denying theological discourse has contributed to racialized designations and to the racial divide. Hence, theological education has an obligation to address race as a matter of correcting the historical record and of influencing contemporary faith-based practices. Consider this. We prepare persons who may be the chaplain to the Black patient in pain. And we prepare persons who may be the pastor to the doctor who manages, undermanages the Black patient in pain. Engaging the tenets of CRT can aid in our efforts to be responsible practitioners of our sacred call in theological education to prepare persons for ministry. In his historical review of theological education, Gusto Gonzalez makes an interesting observation regarding the relationship between theology and other academic disciplines. He notes that theology gave birth to universities, but became excluded during the time of the Enlightenment in favor of objective and scientific methodologies, thereby forcing theological educators to do the same. That is, attempt to produce objective theological insights. The absolute irony of this observation is that the sciences of that time, particularly as they related to race and racial differences, was in no way objective, but set out to prove, in the words of philosopher David Hume, and I quote, "Negroes and all other species of men are naturally inferior to whites," unquote. The consequence of this academic slight, according to Gonzalez, was that theological educators divided into fundamentalists loyal to scripture and liberals loyal to science, who produced scholarship with no usefulness to the church. As educators preparing persons to minister to soul and body, we must take seriously the ways our institution, created by white males for the education of white males, contributed to the current socio-political landscape and thus engaged ways the mischaracterization of human flesh as divinely hierarchical can be corrected and translated into a more equitable society. I offer the following suggestions. When teaching, we must be mindful of notions of objectivity, neutrality, meritocracy, and colorblindness in the classroom. For example, unless one is medically colorblind and legitimately cannot see colors, then we cannot pretend that the color of one's skin is meaningless, whether as student or teacher. Positive and pejorative associations are drawn whether the physical body presents as white or as a person of color. In fact, Black scholars Anthony Penn, Nancy Lynn Westfield, both have asserted that the body becomes written text in the classroom. Of course, I don't mean to suggest that race is discernible to the natural eye. However, physical appearance or common knowledge, that is, common beliefs about race, was once the criteria the courts used for assessing racial designation. As white supremacy is maintained in the society via the institutionalization of specific images, We must be attentive to representations of race that support dehumanization and disenfranchisement, and thus closely and critically examine the same in ways the physical presence of ourselves and students are engaged in the along with the literature in our field. Are the insights and contributions of some students ignored, overlooked, dismissed? Then we must be intentional about inviting them to speak or to clarify or to be engaged much more seriously. Of course, the most obvious means of dismantling objectivity, neutrality, meritocracy, and colorblindness is for professors to include a range of voices in our required reading that influence our respective field and that reflect our student population. While it is still relevant for students to study what was affectionately referred to in my Methodist seminary as dead white men, it is equally important to study the impact their perspectives had upon people of color in their time and now. By so doing, professors can also demonstrate the expectation of critical analysis expected in written and oral assignments by noting short-sightedness of authors in the assigned readings. Modeling this expectation encourages students to identify gaps in scholarship, which may lead to further academic study on their part. This additional analysis is essential. As Miguel de la Torre and Stacey Floyd Thomas have observed, saying, Euro-American pastors, Bible scholars, and theologians have reinforced prevailing political, social, and economic structures that historically have been devastating to communities of color. Moreover, the shifting demographics in theological education, according to the accrediting body, suggest an increase from 27.7% in 1995 of Black, Indigenous, and people of color to 44.8% attending ATS participant schools in 2020. These graduates will need to be mindful of ministry practices in their own demographic. For example, as a hospital and hospice chaplain, I was trained in providing pastoral care to patients and families of Jewish and Islamic faiths and to non-English speaking patients and families. But only recently are hospitals beginning to give attention to Black cultural practices in pastoral caregiving. Theological education must likewise begin to provide the same practical theological training to be culturally sensitive to the various communities in our student population will serve. I also suggest that professors require what womanist religious educator calls a religious autobiography. This is something that I do, which is a self-reflection that assesses the personal impact of social location upon the contents of an approach to education. This exercise can help students identify their explicit, implicit, and null curriculums and where intentionality must be given in order to be inclusive. Finally, I suggest cross-cultural co-teaching and/or invited guests to share historical context and differing cultural perspectives of course material. Such analysis coming from differing voices should illustrate there is no such thing as objectivity, neutrality, or meritocracy in theological education. Rather, context matters. Since the academy requires innovation, we're always looking for new ways to address old problems and or to extend knowledge. For example, critical race theory started in the field of law and has since expanded to other academic disciplines such as education, politics, criminal justice, gender studies. In addition, critical race theory has splintered into theoretical frameworks for explaining and examining events such as race and disability studies, known as DISCRIT, that combines disability studies with CRT, Asian CRIT that combines Asian studies with CRT, and LatCRIT that combines Latinx studies with CRT. Outside the US, CRT has been applied to investigation of caste in India, gypsies in Europe, and Muslims in British schools. Since CRT asserts the fluidness of racial identity, I believe researching who is Russian would be a phenomenal study in theological education right now. Stating explicitly our social location and intensive inquiry and analysis would go a long way to deconstruct notions of objectivity, neutrality, meritocracy, and colorblindness in our research. Some liberation scholars already engage this practice of naming. However, without such acknowledgement slash disclaimer, as it were, the presumption of universal speak inherent in traditional theological discourse is ever present. Also, in the naming of social location, we must acknowledge places of privilege as well as experiences of dehumanization and disenfranchisement. I, for example, by multiple intersecting socio-political identities, enjoy places of hegemonic privileges that persons who identify as LGBTQ+, disabled, and or lower income, for example, may not. Given the dwindling budgets for many of our institutions and specifically for our libraries, we may want to consider submitting our research for publication in journals out of our academic field or to open access journals, not only for greater exposure, but also as an act of resistance to the notion of meritocracy, that publishing in specialized journals is better, even though those outside our respective guilds and our institutions may benefit from our may not benefit from our research due to library budget cuts, in that, of course, they don't have access. In fact, since many of us save the environment by receiving online versions only of our guild journals, I could not even ask my peers to peruse a hard copy of their biblical studies or homiletical journal, for example. I also believe there needs to be more research, ethnographic research in practical theological discipline. So we need to search out funding for that. Regarding our service to seminary, divinity school, university, guild, church, communities, decision makers in theological education must be intentional about including historically excluded voices on panels, committees, and invited guests. Once present, those of us who are members of the Historically Excluded Voice Committee must be intentional about raising concerns. While there is certainly no guarantee our presence could prevent embarrassing, our voices will be heard, our presence could prevent embarrassing moments like the one for educational publisher McGraw-Hill, who in 2015 had to revise and reprint a geography textbook that referred to enslaved Africans as migrant workers after a parent complained because no one on their staff thought it problematic to refer to an enslaved person as an agricultural worker. In an age of social media, our presence and our voice could spare institutional embarrassment and help to shape the direction of our guilds and institutions. In closing, let me note that by and large, the US is an ill-informed, poorly educated nation. In fact, miseducated, particularly regarding US history and race relations. According to the World Population Review, the United States consistently scores lower than many other countries in math and science. And the 2018 Business Insider reported that US education ranking was 38th in math and science. We should not therefore be surprised by the current widespread attack on an embrace of not teaching CRT in K-12 education, where the subject is not usually part of the curriculum, nor by the passing of legislation prohibiting the mandating of attendance at diversity trainings that cause discomfort, guilt, anguish, or any form of psychological distress for actions committed in the past by members of the same race, color, sex, or national origin. To be clear, we are not lamenting the actions of the past. The U.S. remains, by definition, a settler colony, despite its revolutionary break from British rule. Settlers occupy the land, desecrate sacred ground, impose imported culture, making their language, religion, ways of being, knowing, and doing superior and required for the indigenous and the colonized people. Settlers establish boundaries of access and opportunities for themselves and for the newly dehumanized and disenfranchised others. Settlers have no intention of nor any incentive for sharing the privileged world of their own creation, or of leaving the country built for the protection and promotion of their self-interest. According to Georgia State Law Professor Natsu Taylor Saito, the vision of America as a white supremacist patriarchal settler society is alive and well today. Ignoring this reality is no longer an option. This colonial structure was set up with religious assistant of the Christian European missionaries, who J.D. Otis Roberts said cooperated with the colonial administrator in raping lands of their resources and of raping people of their human identity. The circumstance now demands the corrective that theological educators can provide. Hence, the urgency is now for us to engage critical race theory as we prepare the next generation of ministers. I thank you for your time.
Thank you very much, Dr. Fears. Wonderful, powerful overview of CRT and a set of challenging recommendations, if not calls, to theological schools and educators to look at the dynamics of racialized power and encounters with students and with one another through some of the lenses of CRT and through its resources. I do want to invite people to share questions. I just want to lay out our hopes for that process. We ask you to remain muted until you are, I guess, recognized, and you can either put up an emoji hand or hold up your hand, and I will try to recognize you. And we do ask you to, if you need to give a context for your question, do so briefly, but try to move to the question. We Presbyterians only preach on Sundays now, although I know my Baptist colleagues and many other are ready to share the word anytime, but I ask you not to share the word today, except perhaps in the form of a question, because passion and justice and a reckoning, we're in a day of reckoning, and those are certainly very welcome. So I invite you to share questions, and I am just going to begin as you're thinking of one you would like to share, and feel free to put your questions in the chat as well for others to think about. Of course, I am struck, Dr. Fears, by your call to account for theological schools and our theological traditions to critically become aware and to become accountable for the religious rationalizations we have brought to racial injustice, to racializing power and relations, especially in this country. I'm thinking about the many practical suggestions you have made about pedagogies and assessment and looking at the fields we teach in and how they need to be self-scrutinized as well. But there's a great deal theoretically to be done as well, is there not? And I'm thinking, I come from a very confessional Reformation tradition. And so do we need to dig into not only this, the history of interpreting scriptures, of course, which I think you did mention, but also the historic confessions that may inform some of our communities?
Well, I would suspect that's true. And that's what I meant by looking at the works of like a Martin Luther, John Calvin. What were their comments and their context and the impact that had to say, and all I can think of for Calvin right now is tulip. I'm sorry, I'm trying to blank here. What did it mean for them who still had certain access? Remember, Luther had access to, was it kings, as I recall, as compared to, say, someone pouring in the field for the confessions that he would come up with, who may not have to give or to do, or it makes it difficult. So to me, yes, we would have to look at those historical, the historical time frame, what was going on, who the speakers had access to at that time, the context. I mean, what I kind of vaguely remember about Luther, for example, is he seems to have been a depressed man. And how is it that some of the issues that concerned him now become the problem of the whole church? Mm-hmm. Same thing with Augustine. Mm-hmm. It's kind of what I vaguely remember. Remember, I'm a religious educator. So yes,
yeah, but going back to the beginning, you're suggesting is very important. Very
right.
Good.
Absolutely.
Thank you. Other questions that you might have?
Which says it's not objective. Going back to the particular theme I highlighted, mine is not objective.
Yes, very good. Shell from United Lutheran Seminary.
Thanks, Larry. Thank you, Dr. Fear, so very much. I'm struck, apostolizing a little bit, I'm struck by, I don't know if anybody's been watching and listening to the hearing, the Senate hearing today of Ketanji Brown Jackson for her approval as a Supreme Court Justice. And Senator Ted Cruz was hammering her on critical race theory. Senator Cruz set a very good example of people's complete ignorance in understanding what critical race theory is. And so I suspect we're going to be hearing a lot more about this in the coming days because of his very strong showing of the ignorance of this. My question is a follow along with Larry about I'm a director of contextual formation for the seminary. I'm also going to be helping with reworking our curriculum. We're getting ready to go into a curriculum revision, and I've volunteered my services as a Christian educator to help with the curriculum creating. How can I tell my colleagues, my teaching colleagues, what are ways that I can help teach them to pay more attention in their coursework and the things that they're encouraging their students to do that can further us in understanding critical race theory and also then helping our students live into that as they go into ministry?
Okay. Well, I actually think there should be a course called Critical Race Theory in Theological Education or in whatever would be appropriate for your setting that highlights and takes more. I mean, I highlighted just one theme, and that was the liberalism. But there's racial realism, there's whiteness as property, there's a series of other things within that the framework suggests. So to broaden the discussion, someone could come in and certainly describe it more comprehensively. But we start with admitting certain truths. that being country, the country and many of our curriculums reflect a certain racial bias. And we need to look at what those courses may be, what the textbooks choices may be, and what the learning goals and outcomes may be. Even some of the assignments, I was thinking about this, there was just no space to place it because of a different assignment I did for Wabash or something I was working on for Wabash. Even our learning styles are different. Some of us are better orally, and the academy seems to reward written assignments. Not everyone is a great writer. What is the balance of written assignments to oral assignments in the respective classrooms? Are you providing assistance with that as part of your, with writing as part of your curriculum development? And then how sensitive are people going to be? When I think, for example, I alluded to it, the Florida law references what people did in the past. We're not talking necessarily about the past. We're talking about stuff that happens to us every day. So it's not, we're mad about something that happened 400 years ago. We're mad about something that probably happened half hour ago. The truth is told. And that's the disconnect in having honest conversations about race, because we seem to think, oh, this is over. Really? I'm kind of afraid to go see what Ted Cruz said now. I missed it, so I have no idea what he said.
For your own sanity, just don't. Just don't.
I spoke with a president of an HBCU divinity school today, and he said, I'm not going to watch it because I do not want to be injured again. And it's all just waiting for waiting for tomorrow, I think. Other questions that this esteemed group has for Dr. Fierce?
Just one last little, Dr. Fierce, Martin Luther had lots of intestinal issues, so he was cranky all the time.
Okay. Well, there you go.
Larry, Emily Peck has her hand up.
Oh, Emily, please.
Hi, Emily.
Thank you. Hi, Dr. Fierce. Thank you so much for your presentation. I appreciate it so much. When I hear talks like this or read things, I'm constantly making connections that I never did before. And one of those connections that came up for me during in the chapter and in what you shared was you explicitly said that, you know, the people who come into our classrooms have come through this racist K-12 educational system. And I have never thought about that before, that like everything that makes me uncomfortable about U.S. education, particularly in the South, looking at textbooks, that all of that isn't actually separate from what happens in my classrooms, even though I'm not in a K-12 classroom. So I really appreciate you helping me to make that connection in particular. But I want to ask a similar question, because I had a conversation with Jack Seymour a few weeks ago, and he said something like 40% of students in the South are homeschooled. Hmm. And that to me is a whole other layer to be thinking of here. I mean, I personally would feel like 20% is a large number. So 40% like blew my mind.
Are we talking white students, Emily?
He didn't specifically say. He said a lot of it is more conservative Christian households who are homeschooling their kids. But I'm wondering, as we consider that, you know, a percentage, perhaps a large percentage of our students may be coming from that background instead of the public school system, which also has its own problems. You know, if there's another kind of layer of complication or anything that you might share some insights with us about when we think about the homeschooling community coming into our classrooms.
Well, I admit to having given a great deal of thought about that, but what comes to mind in the question and the reason I raised K through 12 is people are taught through the test in K through 12 because I keep referring to it as No Child Left Behind. I think it has a different name now. And I would assume even in the homeschool, you have to demonstrate that you are passing each grade level and you are doing whatever is required and you're not playing out in the yard to make sure that you go to the next level. So my question is, where is the space for the creative thought? Where is the space for the critical thought? And that's the challenge that our current system presents. And then if the home environment doesn't lend itself to that, because I'm discovering among my students, you know, they come from a church environment where they couldn't ask questions. It was discouraged. Totally foreign to me. I mean, my mother did try to tell me to stop, but that never worked. How do we get them to, I certainly do my part to encourage them that questioning is a good thing. This is certainly how one learns. But even if the home environment is not doing the same, if the reason for being at home is to avoid some exposure to something in the classroom, in the public school system, then I still think we're defeating the purpose. Where do we learn to engage and to think beyond the immediacy of our own home environment, except in the school system, where you are exposed to different people from different homes with different ideas, and you can kind of bat them back and forward and say, okay, well, I hadn't considered that. I mean, this is going to sound like a probably very poor example or analogy, but it reminds me of foods. I grew up in a household, we had meat and potatoes every day. It wasn't until I got to a junior high school that I was introduced to things like pizza. That was totally different. And that's how I feel about, I mean, we had pork chops, chicken roll, I mean, that kind of meal. That's how I feel about people who are perhaps homeschooled. If they don't have the support network around them, then they're not gonna get the books and the questions and the engagement they need to think beyond the immediacy of their home environment.
Wonderful. I never saw a bagel before I went to college. Can you believe it? My Jewish friend looked at me like, what? I think I saw a hand. Okay. Other questions that arise? While we're waiting, Dr. Fears, I have a question of pedagogies, especially around assessment. And one pedagogy, this is not an assessment pedagogy, but the religious autobiography piece was just stunning to me, and that makes so much sense. And I've done a lot of work with narrative leadership and narrative use in ministry, and I've always encouraged us to do that in a more kind of social first couple of weeks, getting to know each other kind of view, but as a pedagogical tool in the classroom, I think it's just powerful. Did I hear you also mention portfolios as an alternative to the strict academic paper? And if not, do you like portfolios for students as an alternative to a research paper?
I didn't mention portfolios, but I do teach a class called Senior Colloquy where they have to do something similar and a paper. Because in that class, that is the capstone course where they're pulling together the entirety of their educational experience and preparing to graduate, job search, etc. Then I want them to pull together things they've learned and done in preparation for the interview process and what that means. If you're before a search committee or you're in a pastoral type position or before a chaplain, supervisor type scenario. I believe Dr. Ware requests a credo in one of his theology courses. And then the written assignment I require in that class is an integrative paper on the various aspects of the church experience. So it integrates theology, Bible, church history, religious education, worship, et cetera, et cetera. But
Yes. Yeah, well, I'm just struck by the student-centered pedagogies that you're suggesting are just really powerful for allowing multiple voices in the room and giving space. And I'm sorry that Renee Harrison had to leave, because she has co-authored a book on engaged teaching and engaged teaching, theology, religion, and has many of the student-related pedagogies in it. I highly recommend Dr. Harrison's book on engaged teaching as an example. Other questions that you might have? Also want to include our guests who are here as either theological students or pastors and also educators in other institutions outside the WTC. You're feel free to ask questions as well.
Is this a visceral reaction?
Well, maybe people are tired. It is 5 o'clock. I just hate to lose this opportunity for the engagement with you, Dr. Fears, and I've grown up in a period watching schools redesign their canons, right, for the Western Civ course, for example. And my West Coast college just totally redesigned as a course in cultural engagement or global literature. I don't remember how they did it, but it's a huge battle, right, to get off even in English literature or written literature, to get off the classics that were from Europe or America, largely by white men, not entirely. I know theological educators that say we need to do the same thing in our sense of canon within our theological schools. And any comments about that and how to negotiate that conversation with faculties and what an ideal canon would look like?
I'm sorry, I got distracted by the chat. Could you say that again? This is why I can't keep...
Oh, I got you. I'm sorry.
A question about the year, and I believe the year is 2009. It was at least my of the article, so my apologies.
I can look that up.
The question.
Yeah, the edition is 2016, the book, but I think yes, the article is earlier. That's right.
Right.
I didn't include that in the notes. The question is, I've watched many colleges go through the question of redesigning the canon of the required Western civilization course or their critical engagement with culture course and moving towards either more global paradigm or at the time in my West Coast college, it was it's called a kind of cross-cultural or intercultural paradigm. And yet the battles to do that are pretty tough among faculty. But I'm sensing, we're at a period, and I Willie, Jennings and others have really pushed us to say, we're at a period, we need to redesign our canons within our schools. What are our theological canons? And do you have any recommendations for how to negotiate that conversation with faculty? And what's my, if you had an ideal canon in a, let's say a mixed race school, multiracial school, what that might look like?
We've had some discussions, and we all tend to dig in our heels and think our discipline is absolutely essential. How dare you take this away? So you're absolutely right. Those are extremely difficult conversations to have. I was reading Carrie Day's book on theological education in preparation for this. I believe there is a space for the history, because since scholarship builds, we have to have some history to know why we do womanism, why we do Latinx, why we do CRT, et cetera. And knowing some of the old, what we call the traditional or class, I hate those terms, but traditional or classical, we have to know them. We have to have some some exposure at the very least. But at the same time, those are required and the contemporaries tend not to be. And that's where I think there is the problem. And that's what we need to include. There also probably should be more tracks for those who are going into a parish ministry, for example, should have one set of requirements and maybe keep certain disciplines happy. And then those who are going into chaplaincy will require other tracks. I question if there are not too many required courses that don't give students enough flexibility to take the courses that speak to specifically to their vocational call and or plans as they understand it. So I'm kind of hesitant to say thou shalt take this, but I do think there is a way to reach a balance, because clearly we need an understanding of scripture. I, as a religious educator, would throw in two classes of religious education. We seem to think pastors do it all. Well, technically they can't, but again, the budgetary restrictions may force them to. I am not a musician, so of course I look at something like that and think, why is this class necessary? But as a chaplain, I'm like, well, why isn't that class necessary? So I there's a struggle here for me in responding to that, but I think the answer that might keep us all happy and at the Thanksgiving table is if we have our tracks.
Yeah, maybe. Yeah, but you're also asking individual professors to shift the core of their own syllabi, aren't you?
And it makes I them, am.
Yeah.
And this
yeah.
is my
maybe concern. That's a grounded up way of changing the body of literature. Yeah.
My concern, I was looking at some information and from ATS. I believe 70% of maybe I can't remember now if it was school memberships or if it were the student population was evangelical. What influence that may have on the direction they give us? That's going to be problematic with someone like me, who I consider is mainline. I don't want them telling me that. Matter of fact, I would prefer less evangelical. In fact, what's his name? Gonzalez makes a comment about the way we split that is detrimental. He actually referred to it as the canonization of ignorance.
Ah, nice.
That was the term he used. Where we can't seem to come to a balance on historical critical use of scripture versus people wrote it on their Apple Macs.
Right. Or the golden tablets. Yeah. I'm not picking on anybody. I'm just, anyway. Okay. Other comments, anything anyone would like to share before we end our time together today?
Yeah, I'm Shell Huth, United Lutheran Seminary again. Thank you so much. First of all, it does my heart joy to hear another Christian educator presenting. So thank you for that. And also that hearing the student perspective around their learnings and the vitality that comes from that. I teach a certificate in congregational faith formation. And there are books that they're required to read, and I ask them to do a two-page paper on the book. The first part, tell me what are learnings that you got from this? What are ahas or reminders or things that make you scratch your head? And the second part is, how can you see the implications of what you've read in your current context in ministry or ministry that you're going to be called to into the future? How will this benefit you as you move into ministry? Mm-hmm. And so hearing their stories has just been really rich for me as a teacher and affected me as a teacher and my teaching. So thank you for lifting that up. I'd be Yes, thank you for that. And I, that's one that I continue to kind of beat with my other faculty members is, where are you having opportunity for students to use their voices and their thinking instead of just regurgitating the information, but actually being critical thinkers around how this is going to be affecting them as a leader and their ministry going into public ministry in the world. And so that's a helpful thing to hear. Yeah, thank you.
Oh, thank you for sharing. I agree wholeheartedly. We have to listen. Part of, is it the next, Brookfield. I mean, part of our own teaching and updating is some of the reflection we get from the students, as well as our, you know, our peers and so forth. So that's one way I enhance my classes, bring in new scholarship and think, oh, okay, maybe they need to know this.
Yes. You know, speaking of new scholarship and things to read as educators, if you wouldn't mind, Dr. Fierce, at least listing the authors that you mentioned in your presentation.
Okay.
And if you think of the title, that one of the key titles or articles to list, I don't want you to develop a full bibliography for us, but at least the authors, I think that would be really, really helpful for those of us who are new to critical theory, like myself, critical race theory, rather, mm-hmm. And then we could email that and share that more broadly.
Okay. All right. I mean, I could rattle off a few.
If we had the top five, what would be your recommendation? You mentioned Bell a number of times.
Derek Bell. He has Faces at the Bottom of the Well. And why am I drawing a blank on the other one? Yeah, Faces at the Bottom of the Well, and We Are Not Yet Saved. Now, he writes those stories. He has a, I don't want to say a mythical friend, but a Geneva Crenshaw who goes back in time to kind of, as though she were at one of the constitutions and talks about race. But Richard, this is just kind of a straightforward, very simple summary type book. I'm trying to think of all my books are close here. Oh, and this one is just because it's about education. One that you would like, Critical Race Theory, again by Kimberly Crenshaw. It's the one that I had to read when I was in school. The key writings that form the race. Now that's a pretty thick book, but that's where you get a slew of other authors. The one that I suggested, and the reason that I use Gladson, Gloria Ladson Billings, was because she was one of the first scholars to use it in education. Mm-hmm. And I thought the education application would be appropriate to theological education.
Yes.
That was the extrapolation I was trying to make.
I would encourage you to ask your librarians to get this.
Yeah.
I couldn't find a library that had it in the WTC, but that was through WorldCat. It may be behind. That's from the readings for today. Yeah.
Yeah. Who else do I have? Let's see. Kyra Bridges. I mean, there is just a slew of people that come to mind.
Mm-hmm.
I will send you the name of maybe 10, and that way just 10 would be sufficient.
That would be excellent. That would be really helpful to all of us.
Yeah.
Any other comments that anyone wants to share with Dr. Fears or with one another?
If I may, Larry.
Yes, please.
Dr. Fears, while I am not a Christian educator by profession, I am the recipient of all that you provide in terms of pastors and people working with parishioners. So I want to know, what is our responsibility to make sure that the facts are known about critical race theory. We're not educators, but what is our responsibility when we see people saying ignorant things to help them understand the reality of critical race theory?
Well, I'm all for correcting miseducation. So I would call it out, but then I'm far more comfortable with doing that. I don't know how comfortable everyone else is, and say that's absolutely not true. I'm happy to, again, share this list of resources. That critical race theory is 50 years old. Why are you complaining about it now? I know that's one thing that's just, other than the purpose is to create a wedge issue for the election cycle. That is clear why this has become an issue now. One of the arguments, of course, is that Bell makes is we align since Bacon's Rebellion. Prior to Bacon's Rebellion, for example, only landowning people from Britain were white. Before that, they were not. And so there is a concept within critical race theory called whiteness as property, where one's white skin is a property right that is jealously guarded. And so that is something else that you could respond back to. This notion that, because there's a commercial on MSNBC that drives me crazy, where this woman is screaming, racism in reverse is still racism. Well, how is that possible? People of color are not in positions of power to enforce any racial prejudice we may have. It isn't to say that people of color can't be bigoted, but what difference does it make? We can't change the laws. We can't get a law that says don't make us upset. We can't get a law that says you can't vote. So it's a pushback on these notions. I believe in giving examples. One thing within critical race theory is this notion that people don't know they have, that those who benefit from racism don't know that they have it. Well, most of us don't protect something that we don't know we have. As a general rule. I mean, if someone were to say to me, and I shared this example the other day, hey, there's $1 million in your apartment. Let me come look. I don't have $1 million in my apartment. Have at it. But if they said, I know you got some jewelry. Well, you know, I have a few pieces I worked for. I'm going to say, no, you can't have the emerald ring. No, you can't. I'm going to hold on to that because I know that I have that. I'm going to protect that. This notion of you don't know you have privilege. Yes, you do. And because the entirety of our existence is not one big oppressive experience, we know what it's like to have privilege. If we're educated, if we have money, then we know what it's like to have privilege. So that's how we can recognize it. What most of us don't have is entitlement. That's the difference. Mm-hmm. We don't seem to think I deserve this because of whatever. We just recognize we have this because I have, you know, I'm educated or whatever it is that you may have. The other difference that I tend to make, because I hear this a lot with affluent people of color, is what difference has that made for some of our rich, wealthy, well-to-do people when they can still have the N-word painted on their door, like LeBron James, for example, or was it the gate? I can't remember now. So our money doesn't protect us. We had a president that wasn't allowed to pick a Supreme Court justice. So CRT is very political, by the way. I forgot to put that in there. Actually, it was in there. I took it out. But these are things that we have to say when people are giving misinformation, particularly around racism. Blacks and people of color cannot be racist. We can internalize the racism, but we cannot be racist. Why? Because we don't pull the levers of power.
Yes. Thank you. Thank you very much. Well, I just want to say I deeply appreciated you calling to account the kind of Christian rationalizations and nationalism, which rationalize early forms of white supremacy and the culture of whiteness. One thing I've been studying more deeply in my own faith tradition, the Presbyterian tradition, is we were right at the center of that. Some of the greatest ideologues came out of my tradition, whether they were liberal or conservative, didn't matter. But the early forms of that were not just regarding people of color, but who qualified as white, which you intimated earlier. Right. Catholics weren't white because they couldn't be good Americans, because, you know, the whole history of anti-Catholicism is rampant. And we were right at the center of that in my spiritual forebears. And it's something I've come to deeply appreciate as I've reclaimed one of my names as an English Catholic family. That he was a Confederate war hero is another issue. I don't claim that part anymore. He was not wearing blue, I'm sorry to say. But I grew up, you know, Southern family. But the English Catholic thing has come to mean something to me. And, you know, we have these personal narratives which interact with our faith narratives, which interact with our social and political narratives. And one of the powers of CRT is that narrative engine, I think, that came through in the readings as well. So I'm very grateful for that. Any other final comments?
Thanks for sharing, because the Irish weren't white at one point, neither were the nope. Italians.
Nope, and the Germans. Yep, they were even the Lutheran ones, because they spoke this weird language. Sorry, Shell. And they just, you know, they did not fit in the Anglo-Protestant agenda for the nation. And that's why Christian nationalism is really not so weird. Mm-hmm. It's kind of as normal in a way as racism is in our country. Right. And we should say Protestant nationalism, although it's morphed now to have allies right. in other groups, as we've seen. But, you know, I have my mainline friends just are chagrined at all this Christian nationalism. And I gave a sermon on, listen, let me tell you, we invented all the tools in our own Presbyterian church. And I went through it, and their jaws were on the floor afterwards. And then they're all riled up. They want to do something about it. These levels of accountability, I think, are just really, really crucial for many of us to be engaging. I just want to thank each of you for your time today. I just want to point out that we have representatives from United Lutheran Seminary, Virginia Theological Seminary, Howard University School of Divinity, Wesley Theological Seminary, John Leland Center, especially the Institute for Justice Formation, and Catholic University of America. We have a couple of guests who are with us as well from various organizations and churches. And an apology from the dean, academic dean of Catholic University, who a faculty search took him away from this session, but he's eager to hear about the results. That was Bob Miller, who's a very gifted biblical scholar. I do want to thank each of you. If I missed anyone in the affiliations, we also have a professor from Georgetown University, by the way, with us, and very grateful for Beverly being with us as well. Well, blessings to each of you in this shared journey of a new era of reckoning and deeper equity and justice on issues of race and the intersectional issues which come with it. So I'm indebted to such a vibrant faculty group as this.